Hi guys, welcome back to the Political Reading Corner, where we talk about the politics of American literature. Today, we're going to discuss how Sui Sin Far's short story, In the Land of the Free, appeals to readers' motherhood values to demonstrate the destruction caused by the Chinese Exclusion Act and to motivate readers to disagree with its policies. So let's get into it. Sui Sin Far, also known as Edith Maud Eaton, was a Chinese-American woman who wrote a collection of short stories called Miss Spring Fragrance, which was published in 1912. They explore a variety of themes, but one specific theme is how the Chinese Exclusion Act prevented Chinese mothers from coming to America and being proper mothers to their children. So, to understand this story, you'll need to understand the Chinese Exclusion Act. In the 1850s, there was a gold rush, and many Chinese men came to America to mine gold. This began a period of anti-Asian discrimination. A publication entitled The Events Leading Up to the Chinese Exclusion Acts, published in 1912, describe how the Chinese Exclusion Act didn't just magically come to be in 1882. It was part of a larger process designed to exclude Chinese Americans from the United States. This publication reflects on how capitalists loved the Chinese men because they would work for lower wages than the American men's in the mines. This caused American men to have anti-Chinese sentiments. These sentiments developed into quickly increasing taxes on miners and eventually caused riots and attempted lynchings of Chinese men. These aggressions continued to build. According to scholar Erika Lee, in 1876, H.N. Clement, a San Francisco lawyer, stood before a California State Senate committee and sounded the alarm. The Chinese are upon us. How can we get rid of them? The Chinese are coming. How do we stop them? In 1882, the Chinese Exclusion Act was passed. Lee explains that this law prohibited the immigration of Chinese laborers for a period of 10 years and barred all Chinese immigrants from naturalized citizenship. Demonstrating the class bias in the law, merchants, teachers, students, travelers, and diplomats were exempt from the exclusion. While politicians claimed this act was passed to protect America from Chinese immigrants, who were said to have competed too much for American men's wages, and whose women were stereotyped as prostitutes, noted political activist William Lloyd Garrison lashed out against this reasoning in a publication from 1902. He argued that the Chinese Exclusion Act was a political move made to gain the support of labor workers. The labor sector held especially extreme prejudice against Chinese workers, and it was coincidentally the labor voter bloc that each political party needed to win over in order to win the election. So, they both ran with anti-Chinese policies as part of their platform. While the act was passed in 1882, scholar Erika Lee argues that its influence continues today because it was the first gatekeeping policy that legalized and reinforced the need to restrict, exclude, and deport undesirable and excludable immigrants. Additionally, it provided the structure for the U.S. to monitor and control who was arriving in the U.S., such as through the use of passports, green cards, and deportation strategies, something that had not existed before the act. Lee explains that understanding the racialized origins of American gatekeeping provides a powerful counter-narrative to the popular immigrant paradigm, which celebrates the United States as a nation of immigrants and views immigration as a fulfillment of the promise of American democracy. Lee points out that America promises to be the land of opportunity and a melting pot of people from around the world, but policies like the Chinese Exclusion Act show that ideal simply doesn't exist in reality. So there's one more part of the act you'll need to understand before we dive into Far's text. The Chinese Exclusion Act prevented Chinese Americans from moving to the U.S. if they had not already been living there. Passed in 1882, the act wasn't repealed until 1943. During this period, the government was afraid immigrants would try to enter the country illegally, so they developed a system of identification documents. Erika Lee explains that Section 4 of the Exclusion Act established certificates of registration for departing laborers. Such certificates were to contain the name, age, occupation, last place of residence, personal description, and facts of identification of the Chinese laborer. This information was also recorded in specific registry books to be kept in the customs house. The certificate enabled the holder to return and re-enter the United States upon producing and delivering the document to the collector of customs. The laborer's return certificate is the first re-entry document issued to an immigrant group by the federal government, and it served as an equivalent passport, facilitating re-entry into the country. Chinese remain the only immigrant group required to hold such re-entry permits or passports until 1924. So Chinese Americans had to have documents proving their right to be in America, and this is going to be important for the story. Which, speaking of, let's get into it. Far's collection was published in 1912, 30 years after the passage of the Chinese Exclusion Act and 30 years before it would be repealed. In the short story, In the Land of the Free, Far illustrates how the Chinese Exclusion Act is preventing motherhood ideals because the act separates families. By targeting motherhood, this value that American women are supposed to prioritize, Far encourages people to rebel against the anti-Chinese discrimination caused by the act and thus protect motherhood. This story begins with hope. The mother is sailing to America and says to her son, "See, little one, the hills in the morning sun, there is thy home for years to come. It is very beautiful and thou wilt be very happy there." This is quite bittersweet considering the story ends tragically. This opening part is important though, because it demonstrates the lack of fear or anxiety that the mother has in coming to America. She doesn't anticipate any problems and she believes her son will have a good future. Lei Chu, the mother, had traveled to China to give birth to her son. Accordingly, she has documents that she has been in America before, but her son does not. When they arrive at the shore, the customs officers, despite having heard an explanation of the situation, say they have no proof that little one should be allowed into the country, and thus, without orders from the government, he must stay with the customs officers. This demonstrates the first violation of motherhood, with Lei Chu's son being taken from her unwillingly. It all ties back to the registration documents required by the Chinese Exclusion Act. Far demonstrates the absurdity of these laws in this scene, depicting how laws that are meant to prevent unregistered workers from immigrating to the country are so broad that they are also preventing small children from coming to the country with their parents. The story continues with a promise that Lei Chu and Little One will only be separated for one day. Lei Chu stays up the whole night and gets ready to collect her son early in the morning. Her husband tells her it is too early, and she emphasizes her motherhood, saying, "You do not know, man, what it is to miss the feel of the little fingers and the little toes and the soft round limbs of your little one." Far emphasizes Lei Chu's motherhood here by depicting her as unable to sleep, unable to do anything but worry, while her husband has a more nonchalant attitude toward the situation. He responds to her anxiety by saying, "There is no need to grieve so. He will gladden you soon again. There cannot be any law that would keep a child from its mother." There cannot be any law that would keep a child from its mother. It's a striking sentence considering the story and their situation, and ultimately it highlights Far's main point. There cannot, by the rules of natural motherhood, be a law that separates mother and child. But there is that law in America, and it is unnatural and wrong and must be repealed. The story picks up 5 months later, and Little One still has not been returned to his parents. The government continually promises to look at their case soon, but never does. Being removed from her child has extreme health consequences for Lei Chu. Her husband tells another man that if the boy not come home, I lose my wife sure, because she eats only when he asks her to. Her tears fall continually and her eyes stare all night. Through this passage, Far demonstrates that Chinese women desperately want to be mothers and to fulfill the same motherhood roles as white American women, but the Chinese Exclusion Act is preventing them from doing so. This desire is so strong that it has health consequences, and Lei Chu would rather die than live without her son. In showing motherhood in this way, Far emphasizes how the Chinese Exclusion Act harms motherhood values and needs to be repealed in order for all American women, immigrants included, to fulfill their motherhood duties as naturally desired within all women. Far further emphasizes this by demonstrating the lengths that Lei Chu will sacrifice personally in order to be reunited with her son. When a lawyer offers to go to Washington and push the government to get their son back, Lei Chu's husband cannot afford the $500 fee. Lei Chu refuses to let this opportunity pass and sacrifices all of her jewelry and valuables as payment. Similar to the depiction of her health, this sacrifice demonstrates just how serious Far is about motherhood. She would rather die or sacrifice all her valuables than be without her son. This exemplifies the motherhood ideal of American tradition, showing that Chinese women are not the prostitute stereotype. They are good mothers that deserve protection under the law. Finally, Lei Chu is reunited with her son. It is not, however, a happy ending. A missionary woman leads Lei Chu through the missionary school where little one is being raised. Well, she tells Lei Chu that little one has been rather difficult to manage at first and had cried much for his mother. This demonstrates the harm that the separationist act does to the child. When Lei Chu finally does get to see her son, she fell on her knees and stretched her hungry arms toward her son, but he shrunk from her and tried to hide himself in the fold of the white woman's skirt. This devastating scene ends with little one telling Lei Chu to go away, go away. Far ends the story this way with little one afraid of his mother, who is now a stranger, to hammer home the theme of the story. The Chinese Exclusion Act harms mothers' ability to properly mother and protect their children, a duty that America supposedly values in women. In her story, Far subverts the stereotype that Chinese women are prostitutes and instead portrays Lei Chu like a white American woman who values motherhood above all else. However, the story also emphasizes that the Chinese Exclusion Act is preventing Chinese women from fulfilling their motherhood duties and is destroying their relationships between mothers and children, even making the children afraid of their own mothers. As scholar Linda Grasso states, the rhetoric of enabling motherhood was used to justify women's involvement in a variety of social and political settings, such as the suffrage, labor, temperance, settlement house, and the women's club movements. In this way, Far simply utilizes the rhetoric established by other social justice activists to advocate for the repeal of the Chinese Exclusion Act. I think we're reaching the end here, folks, but I just want to mention that, as always, there are resources linked down below. I highly recommend that you read Sui Sin Far's collection if you found this one interesting. There's another story about motherhood, but it's related to Chinese assimilation to American practices called The Wisdom of the New. Her stories are super interesting and I encourage you to check them all out. Spread peace, friends.